sit up there on the other end. Sound may have turned everybody on themselves. Praise the Lord. We've got a couple of things we're gonna be doing with our sound room and our video room, and I think everything will get better and better as we go along. If you have your Bibles, we're in the book of Zechariah this morning, and at least next week as well. Too much of this book to even begin to try to summarize in one message. Then, of course, after we finish Zechariah, it'll be Malachi, the last book in the Bible, so this is in the Old Testament. So this Zechariah is next to the last book in the Old Testament. Before we begin on our message or our lesson, it'll probably be more of a lesson than a message this morning, I want to mention something that's really been on my mind. It's a burden. And it's a book and a movie that's out that has gained great popularity. They've already made over $50 million with it. And a lot of people think it's just the greatest thing since sliced bread. But I want to tell you it's not. The name of it is The Shack. A lot of people say they're getting great insight into the Word of God, better than they can the Bible when they see that. But what they're doing, they're learning, they're getting the insight of Satan. That book and that movie is nothing more than out of the pits of hell. It portrays God in a universalist way. And by that it means God can be whatever you want him to be. If you want him to be a woman, he's a woman. If you want him to be a dog, he's a dog. If you want him to be your sports car, he's your sports car. Whatever you want to believe in, and one woman reported this week at one of those talk shows that it has helped her just feel better about herself. Well, I imagine so, because apparently she doesn't want to feel good about God. And the devil will make people feel good about themselves. And I just want to discourage anyone from spending their money to buy that sorry book or watching that sorry movie. And if you hear anybody talking about it, they say they're a Christian, you advise them they may not want to do that. It's misleading a lot of people. Apparently, a lot of people feel good about it. They feel like they know God better. But what it is, they know God less. The God you need to know is the God of this book. No other book. If it's not the God of this book, it's not the God.
Right.
And it's need to be mine. Just need to keep that in mind. All right, if you found Zechariah, if you'll stay with me. We'll be in Zechariah. We're going to read chapter 1, verses 1 through 6 to get our basis for beginning. In the 8th month, in the 2nd year of Darius the king, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, The Lord hath been sore displeased with your fathers. Therefore say thou unto them, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Turn ye unto me, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will turn unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. Be ye not as your fathers, unto whom the former prophets have cried, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Turn ye now from your evil ways and from your evil doings. But they did not hear, nor hearken unto me, saith the Lord. Your fathers, where are they? And the prophets, do they live forever? But my words and my statutes, which I commanded my servants, the prophets, did they not take hold of your fathers? And they returned and said, Like as the Lord of hosts thought to do unto us, according to our ways and according to our doings, so hath he dealt with us. Father, once again I ask you to add your blessing to the reading of your word. I take you to your servant, body, home, mind, soul, and spirit. And let the Holy Spirit bring this great teaching through me. Father, let it be made clear that part of this great book that we'll cover this morning. Let it be clear. Let your will and your purpose for your people's lives be clear. Let your purpose, your will be known for those who do not accept Christ and do not accept your word. Those that seek for God in some other way. Lord, teach us thy way in Christ's name. Amen, amen. You may be seated. Zechariah's name was very common in that day in Israel. The meaning of it is Jehovah remembers. What Zechariah means, Jehovah remembers. And indeed, his writing, the writings of Zechariah, lives up to that name. Jehovah remembers, God remembers, the Lord remembers, because in this wonderful book, Zechariah covers thousands of years of God remembering. He never forgets. The only one thing that I know the Bible says that God ever forgives, and that's confessed sin. That's the only thing I know that God forgives. Everything else he remembers. But the Bible says when we confess our sins and he forgives us, he forgets it. It does not exist in the mind of God. Everything else, God remembers. The good and the bad. He knows who's in church this morning. He knows who's not in church. And he knows the reasons for each. People go to church for different reasons. They're seeking different things in their lives. They're needing different things in their lives. So they go to church hoping to receive different things from God as they come to worship together with him. And those not in church, there's a variety of reasons why people do not come to church. Today we've got a lot that's out traveling and sick and so on. Zechariah's preaching was directed to Judah, which contained Jerusalem, as was Haggai, and as will be Malachi when we get to it. It is believed that Zechariah began his prophecy, his preaching, his teaching, his ministry, at the same Haggai was, and some scholars believe that Zechariah came on the scene prophesying about halfway through Haggai, or the end of the first chapter. It's only two chapters. So at the end of the first chapter, or about halfway through, then Zechariah comes on the scene. Zechariah predicted more about the Messiah than any other prophet of the Old Testament except one, Isaiah. Isaiah is the only prophet of the Old Testament that had more to say about Messiah than does Zechariah. And I've often said, I've said it for years, ever since I started really studying the Word of God, that in the Old Testament, I don't believe there's anyone who lived during the Old Testament days who understood the Messiah more than did Isaiah. Somehow, I think it's because of Isaiah being dedicated to God with the purpose of being God's messenger and to understand God. And God honored that, and Isaiah, as he writes, it says, as if Isaiah has no problems understanding what he's writing. Some of the writers do. When you read it, you can tell from the writing of the word, and sometimes they even admit it. I don't know. Daniel said that. I don't know what this means. I just know what I'm supposed to tell you. But I think he did. But anyway, getting back to Zechariah. Zechariah predicted about the Messiah. He does not overlook the sins of the past, but he stresses divine forgiveness. And that's important. As we study the book of Zechariah, we need to understand that one of the overflowing, controlling elements of this book is that God hates sin, but he loves sinners. And he forgives them because of his marvelous grace. His only fear, it seems that Zechariah has, is that God's call may be in vain and the people that he's preaching to may refuse the word of God as did their fathers. If you read these first six verses, you will notice the repetition of the title for God, Lord of Hosts. Five times in those six verses, Zechariah uses the title, Lord of Hosts. Two other times, he just speaks about the Lord. And the reason for that is that Lord of Hosts title brings with it more authority than just simply the Lord. Now that's enough, but the Lord of Hosts means that he's not only the Lord, he's the Lord of all. He is the Lord of all, even those who reject him, even those who don't know about him, he is still Lord of all. He's Lord of everything. Well, there's a lot in this book, and we've got to get into it. And the first thing we need to notice about kind of an introduction to this book, that Zechariah undergirds what Haggai told him. Here are some things that Haggai says, and then what Zechariah says. Haggai told them to consider their ways. It is time. Is it time for you to live in houses while the temple remains in ruins? In other words, pay attention to where your priorities are, people. Is it with God or is it with self? Zechariah then comes in verse 1, chapter 2, tells them the Lord was angry with their fathers. He's undergirding that. Yes, Haggai was right. God was angry with them. Then Haggai wrote in chapter 1, verse 9, that what they had brought home from their crops, God was going to blow it away because of their unfaithfulness. Zechariah comes back in chapter 1, verse 3, and says, the Lord says, return to me, and I will return to you. Then Haggai says in verse 12 of chapter 1, the people feared in the presence of the Lord. Zechariah says, just as the Lord determined to do to us according to our ways, so did he. Verse 6. The point is that God remembers and that God is faithful. Whatever God says he will do, he is going to do. And that brings us to the message itself. That's just the introduction. The message today has one point, really, that's the introduction. But that one point has eight. And I want to share with you, this is why I think that I need to take this whole time for the message today with this one teaching, but it covers from chapter 1, verse 7 through chapter 6, verse 15. And it's eight visions that Zechariah has. The first thing he writes after getting their attention, he says, God gave me eight visions. Now I want to share these eight visions with you, and I want to try to explain them a little bit, what was going on. Zechariah, in his writing, he sees things that were, the things that are, and the things that shall be. He writes about things that were, things that are, and things that shall be. And when the reader reads and studies the book of Zechariah, you must be very careful that you understand what dispensation that he's talking about. Sometimes he's talking about the past, sometimes he's talking about the present, sometimes he's talking about the future. And of course, as the book goes on, the more there is about the future. So we're going to look at vision number one, is chapter 1, verse 7 through verse 17, and it is the vision of horses. The vision of horses. And this the meaning of this vision is God's anger against the nations and blessings on restored Israel. That's the two meanings of this vision of the horses. Now, in this vision, Zechariah sees a man riding a red horse. And then the Bible says he's standing among the myrtle tree. Now it's not clear whether the rider had gotten off the horse and was standing in the myrtle tree, or whether the rider was sitting on the horse and the horse was standing in the middle of the burger. It's not really clear, but in any way, the rider on the red horse is in the midst of the myrtle tree. Now that's important. Most of the time we read right over these things, but when we talk about the myrtle tree there and in this vision, it's really necessary that we understand the significance of this term, myrtle trees. Down in the ravine, it says he's standing among the myrtle trees down in the ravine. First of all, this man on the horse, the Bible says, is the angel of the Lord. Now, I've always told you, since I've been here, that I'm convinced whenever the Bible, the Old Testament, speaks about the angel of the Lord, he's talking about Jesus Christ himself, who came to earth in either the form of an angel or the form of a soldier or whatever. But this is a manifestation of Christ upon earth. So this one in the myrtle, among the myrtle trees, is Jesus Christ, according to Zechariah. Now the purpose of mentioning the myrtle trees is this. The myrtle tree has a wonderful aroma. It smells great. It'll make you hungry just smelling the myrtle tree. But it has no taste. It's absolutely tasteless. It gives off no taste sensation whatsoever. And the Jews, the Israelites, would relate this to those who do good deeds but did not study the book of Moses, the Bible of their day. That's what they had, the five books of Moses. And those people, when they talk about being amongst the myrtle trees, they're talking about people who are wanting to show good works or good deeds, but they're not studying the Word of God, so they'll know how to do it and give God the proper credit for it. So that kind of sets where we're at. Behind him, Zechariah said, he saw other horses. He saw horses that were red, he saw horses that was speckled, and he saw horses that were white. The angel of the Lord explained that these horses were sent throughout the earth, and they found the world at rest and peace. All right, now, we're in the midst of the myrtle, so we're talking about here for the Israelites, we're talking about them trying to do good stuff, but they're not doing it according to the Word of God. They're trying to come up with their own way of doing things. And then these other horses represents that the horses have gone throughout the world, and the world was in peace and in order, except in Israel. Israel was not at rest, and Israel was not at peace. They had just been in exile for 70 years, and their city, Jerusalem, lies in ruins. So they're not at peace. So the idea is here that the rest of the world seems to be okay, but the people of God's not. We don't stop to think about what some of these things are implying when we read God's Word. But it seems like Zechariah said that Christ on the red horse rides around, and the other riders on horses ride around, and everything seems to be okay except at home. And there's a problem. It had been in exile for 70 years. Then God, the Bible says, God mourned over his beloved people and the land of Israel. Now, we often talk about there's no tears in heaven. The Bible says, God, Revelation, the Bible says, he should wipe away all our tears. But when we hear words like this, God mourned. They may not be tears, but apparently there is mourning. Because God mourned. He looked down and he saw the world, and then he saw little Israel and his people, and he mourned. He may not have cried, but apparently he felt like it. He could have. If he allowed himself to cry, he would have probably cried. The Bible does say in the New Testament that Jesus cried. Jesus wept, it says. So it's not that God cannot experience that phenomena called crying. It is that God can will himself not to, if you so will. God declares in verses 14 and 15, I am very jealous for Jerusalem and Zion. That's why he's mourning. But I am very angry with a nation that feels secure. I was only a little angry, but they add to the calamity. They make me very angry. What's he saying? He's saying that these folks running around thinking they're so okay makes God angry. That's what he just said. Now, that my people are hurting, but the people running around here thinking they're okay, and it makes me angry. I think God is still seeing the same thing around the world today, especially in the United States.
Amen.
We got people every day running around all over this nation. Oh, I'm just fine. Me and a man got it all worked out. Anybody says me and a man's got it all worked out, you know immediately they don't have anything worked out unless they're counting man to devil.
That's right.
God is not man. God himself says, I'm not man that I should lie.
Right.
So it is improper to call God the man.
Yes.
The big guy in the sky. That's totally disrespectful to who God is. That's the kind of thing you may find in that shack stuff. Improper. God is who he says he is in his word. And to this day, the only word, recorded word that God has given for you and I and the rest of the world to understand him and his will and his purpose for us is this word called the Holy Bible.
Oh, that's right.
It's all in one. Nowhere else has God ever recorded that he gave his word except through this. And it is recorded he did that. Then God says, verse 17, I will return to Jerusalem with mercy, or we could say grace. And there my house will be rebuilt. My towns will again overflow with prosperity, and the Lord will again comfort Zion and choose Jerusalem. God is still protecting his nation, Israel, and the Jewish people. For he made a promise to them, and God is a God who keeps his promises.
That's right.
These who preach that God is no longer protecting Israel, that God no longer cares for Israel, they're saying that God broke his promise. That's just not true. God says, I will keep my promise, and I will protect my people. Vision number 2, verses 18 through 21. We find four horns and four carpenters. Now, in the Bible, a horn is a symbol of power and authority. The four horns represents the countries scattered by Judah, Israel, Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. The four authorities here are the four powers that scattered God's people. They are, let me get them right here, Assyria, Egypt, Babylonia, and Medo-Persia. That's the four powers. And then in that same vision, he sees four carpenters. Now remember, we're talking about the sin, the bad, the grace, the good. All this, what we're thinking about. There's sin, there's bad, there's grace, there's good. The horns represent the bad, the four carpenters represent the good. These are the ones that God used to overthrow the enemy of his people. God is directing, but also encouraging his people. God has always let human beings know what his text is. We don't have to wonder. He would say, well, I don't know what God wants me to do. Get in the book and get on your knees, you'll find out.
Man.
God will let you know. Vision 3. In chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Zechariah sees a man with a measuring line. In this vision, he sees this man with a measuring line going to measure Jerusalem and how long it is. Now, the angel came, and told the angel to talk to Zechariah. We get a lot of angels in here. First, we have the angel of the Lord, that's Jesus. Then we have the angel talking to Zechariah. Now we have another angel come on the scene. He talks to the angel talking to Zechariah. And he tells that angel, run, chapter 2, verse 4 and 5, run, tell that young man, Jerusalem will be a city without walls because of the great number of people and animals in it. And I myself will be a wall of fire around it, declares the Lord. And I will be its glory within. So the angel that tells the angel that's talking to Zechariah, this is what Jesus is saying. I will be a wall of fire around the city of Jerusalem, and then I also will be the glory of it within. He's talking about the 1,000-year reign. He's talking about that time when he actually comes back to earth, sets foot on the earth, and reigns from Jerusalem. This millennial reign, at that time, Jerusalem will be a city without walls. It will be much larger than it is now. Israel will once again have all the land that God originally gave. All these people claiming that part of that land is theirs, Jesus will say, get out, it's not yours.
That's right.
It belongs to Israel.
That's right.
And I'm here to take it back. I'm here to take it back, what belongs to my people. Then Zechariah is told that many nations will be drawn to Jerusalem and the Lord during that time. Many nations will be drawn. When Christ sets up his kingdom and he rules from Jerusalem, then nations are going to be drawn to it. Many nations around the world are going to come and they're going to see what Jerusalem has to offer and what Jesus has to offer. Then vision 4. He's moving quickly. And so are we. Vision 4 is Joshua, the high priest, chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. This is about Israel's future cleansing from sin and reinstatement as a priestly nation. The first three visions were about Israel's release from captivity and how it grows and how it prospers. But now we come to the restoration of Israel as a priestly nation, the leaders of the cause of Christ, the cause of God. In chapter 3, verse 5, it talks about a fair mitre, M-I-T-R-E. And what that means in our language is a clean turban. And this clean turban is reinstated to Joshua, to his priesthood in verse 5. And then in verse 9, there's a stone, which is Jesus Christ, with 7 being the number of perfection and completion. And in that day, in the millennium, there will be peace and security, according to verse 10. In this vision, and here's the driving lesson for that. In this vision, Satan is accusing Joshua, representing Israel, and God rebukes him, not because it isn't true, but because of God's gracious love for his people, Israel. That's when he's going to lock up old Satan. He's going to say, it may be true, some of the things you say, Satan, but they still have my love. They are still my people, and I am going to lock you up, you old devil. For 1,000 years, you won't be able to bother any human being upon this earth. That's what that's a sign of. Restoring Jerusalem and Israel as the center of Christianity, of worship to the one true God. Then comes verse 5. See why it's taking one sermon? All it should be two right here, I guess. 5, he sees the golden lampstand stand in olive trees. That's in chapter 4, verses 1 through 14. The theme here is Israel is the light to the nations with Messiah as the leader. He saw this gold lampstand with a bowl of oil at the top of it. And from that bowl of oil, there were 7 channels continually supplying oil to the 7 lights on the lampstand. The 7th here represent the eyes of the Lord, seeing the whole earth. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He will be the one giving forth that. The olive trees are the 2 anointed to serve the Lord on earth. Now, this is not the 2 that get angels get killed. These 2 are to serve the Lord on the earth. He saw the 2 olive trees, he said, standing on each side of the lampstand with 2 gold pipes that continue to supply golden oil to the bowl. This vision is about a personal cleansing of people, the 2 olive trees. Joshua is cleansed as spiritual leader, and Zerubbabel is cleansed as the civil leader. The temple, then get this, this is important. People say, how is the temple going to be built? How are they going to get that done? They're still asking that question. How is it going to be done? The Jews are asking that question. How are we going to build this temple? Here's the answer. The temple will be furnished by the power of the Holy Spirit. It says every mountain, and that's every obstacle to it, will be removed. And when the headstone, which Jesus put in place, the people will ask God for his grace, and he will give it. The temple will be built because the Holy Spirit built and erected a building of it. It will get done. If something needs to be moved from here to there, the Holy Spirit will move it. If something is needed they don't have, the Holy Spirit will provide it. It's through his power they will rebuild the temple. Verse 10 says the day of, talks about the day of small things. And that's the reference we talked about this last week, I believe, about the poor comparison the people are making between the rebuilt temple and the magnificent temple of Solomon. No temple they ever built measured up to Solomon's temple. Verse 10 says, that's the day of small things. That's small things. We might say today, it's not how big the building the church is in, but rather it's how big the church is that's in the building. Think about that. It's not how big the building that the church is in, it's how big is the church that's in the building. A big church can be in a small location. A little building, a little congregation can do mighty things for the Lord. Most of the great revivals of this world have been started with a small number who cried and wept and prayed to get it. Then vision 6, the flying stroke, chapter 5, verse 1 through 4. This speaks of the completeness of judgment on sin. Now there's 3 interesting things right off about this vision. It's odd. First of all, the scrolls are normally seen rolled up. This one is unrolled. You've seen them in the pictures, you've seen them on TV, the scrolls, they have them in there, they still use them. And they got 2 handles, and they it's like the film script thing down here that the library uses, it runs through. One's coming off, one on, and you're turning it. When you want to read, you turn both handles, and that loosens one and tightens it up on the other spoon. And they're always shown rolled up, but this one here is seen unrolled. And now it even gives the exact measurement. The book Bible says that this scroll is 30 feet long and 15 feet wide. Now that's pretty long. Those we see them doing that, this is 15 feet wide. More than 1 or 2 men's going to handle. This is the same size. Why is it that size? Now get this, you're going to love this. That 30 feet long and 15 feet wide that this scroll the completeness of judgment on sin, that represented the Word of God, the completeness of the Word of God. This is the same size as the actual tabernacle that God had Moses build. The actual tabernacle was 30 feet long and 15 feet wide. Now, this is not talking about the compound. There was a fence around it, there was over the compound, and where they did other things. This was actually that tabernacle itself. And the tabernacle itself consisted of the holy place and the holy of holies. That was the tabernacle itself. And that was exactly those lengths. Meaning God is found in His Word. You see, I'm just not making up stuff when I tell you if you want to find God, you read His Word. If you want to know God, you read His Word. If you want to be with God, you read His Word. And He'll tell you how to get there. The angel told what it means. He said, this is the curse that is going out over the whole land. For according to what it says on one side, every thief will be banished. According to what it says on the other side, everyone who swears falsely will be banished. It will enter the house of the thief and the house of him who swears falsely by name. It will remain and destroy. In other words, it said, this word of God will convict, will try, and will destroy all sin. Who's going to try us? God. Who's going to judge us? Jesus Christ. Who's going to carry out the sentence? The Holy Spirit. We will be judged. Verse 7. The woman in the basket. Chapter 5, verses 5 through 11. You got to love the woman in the basket, right? Zechariah saw an ephah, or an ephah. That's a basket that was used for measuring grain. The basket represented the sin of the people throughout the land. This is good. You're going to like this. The woman represented the wickedness, and God pushed the wickedness back into the basket and shut the lid. Okay? So you have the basket, which is the wickedness, sin in that basket. And then this woman who represented the wickedness, he uses the woman, puts her in the basket, and pushes all that back in the basket, and seals the lid. Then two other women come on the scene. Somebody never told God women's not supposed to be in here for a minute. I guess they never told them. Because two other women come on the scene. They lift the basket up into the air between heaven and earth. Zechariah asked the question where the basket was being taken to. He was told in chapter 5, verse 11, to the country of Babylonia to build a house for it. Now, why would he say that? Babylonia is a place of ancient and future idolatry and rebelling against God. Putting wickedness and idolatry back in Babylon according sets the stage for her final judgment according to the book of Revelation chapter 17 and 18. You've got to take your book of Revelation and look up these chapters of his. That's what he's talking about. Then finally, verse 8, the four chariots. Started off with horses, now we've got four chariots. That's found in chapter 6, verse 1 through 5. Then Zechariah saw four chariots coming out from between two bronze mountains. The two bronze mountains may be the righteous divine judgment of God against sin. You might want to look up Revelation chapter 1, verse 15, and Revelation chapter 2, verse 18. Distributed by chariots of war going out into the world in those scriptures. The chariots are pulled by four different colored horses, which could be referenced to the horses of Revelation chapter 6, representing the seal of judgment. The angel told Zechariah, these are the four spirits of heaven going out from standing in the presence of the Lord of the whole world. The one with the black horse is going toward the north. The one to the white horse is going toward the west. The one with the grizzled horse is going to the south, and that leaves the bay horses to go to the west. The praise of the Lord of all the earth expresses a messianic praise when Messiah will have universal rule of Zion. That symbolizes that as he sits on the throne in Zion, in Jerusalem, that his universal rule will go out to all the directions of the earth, all four corners, as we call it, the earth. And there will not be any crying. And there will not be any violence. There'll be no protest. Everybody will be kept in line because the God who can do anything he chooses with him is sitting on the throne. The sad part is it will not stop the people from wanting to sin. It's like with a child. When the parent tells them they can't do something, don't get in the cookies, don't make you a bologna sandwich, don't do any of these things. You sit here and study this lesson until if you don't do anything, and that parent is watching where they can watch that child. That child doesn't dare move. Because that child knows that if they do, they're going to get mama or daddy's chastisement. We see people on the job. The boss comes around. Sometimes people say, hey, boss. If the boss comes around, everybody's tidy. Everybody's working hard. Everybody's getting the job done. Because that boss can see them. If they're sitting down on a job and not getting the job done, they know that boss can fire them. Then it goes on and on and on. At the conclusion of these eight visions, God was satisfied. He instructed Zechariah to symbolically crown Joshua, the high priest. That Joshua can also be pronounced Yeshua, who is Jesus Christ. Christ is the one who will be crowned high priest. With a crown made of silver and gold, that's chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. Joshua wearing the crown would symbolize the Messiah to come. There's so much here. Next week, we will continue where we left off. And if you'll stay with me, and it's still, that's a lot to go. I know it's fast, and it's a lot. Sometimes on a Wednesday night study, sometimes we may not get to one or two verses that we cover because we stop. But we don't have that kind of time this morning to do that. So, but we will divide it up. I don't know whether it'll be one more week or two more weeks. But if you'll stay with us and if you'll read this book of Zechariah, and this is what God is saying through it, and go through these sermons, trust me, you will learn a lot about the Word of God. Remember, next to Isaiah, this book of Zechariah teaches more about the Messiah than any other book in the Old Testament. It's here for a purpose. It's here for a reason. And this word is going out, and the fact that Malachi follows this book is there for a reason also. You'll see that when we get to Malachi. Now, Malachi is situated where it's situated. Why is Malachi the last book of the Old Testament? What happens between Zechariah's preaching and Malachi's preaching? Did they learn? Did they straighten up? Was the church doing what the church is supposed to be doing? Were the people obedient to the word of God? After we get through with Zechariah, Malachi will tell us where they stood before God. Amen. You stand with me for the blessing.